George Washington, A Biography by John R. Alden. Preface and Acknowledgments. If it be true, as has often been said, that each generation writes its own history, it is also true that each generation produces its own biographies. Such a statement without qualification is tinged with cynicism. Every biographer worthy of the name takes what advantage he can of the labors and perceptions of his predecessors. Many lives of George Washington, beginning with the famous one by Parson Weems, have come from the press. Two massive ones, by Douglas S. Freeman and his aides, and by James Thomas Flexner, appeared not long ago. They should be consulted by readers who wish to know more about Washington than is chronicled in this book. The Freeman volumes deal with him on almost a day-to-day basis. We now have a much better understanding of Washington than was available in the past. Scholars have ceased to put gilding upon a wooden hero. It has become clear that he possessed an interesting personality. Thus, there can now be no doubt that he was gifted not only with a keen perception of irony, but with an earthy sense of humor. Illustrations of the latter are offered herein. Thus, the present writer hopes that the decades of study he has spent upon the era of the American Revolution have made it possible to contribute a lucid and balanced account of Washington as a military commander, and to assess correctly his role as defender of the American nation during his presidency. There can be no change in the considered verdict of all his worthy biographers, and of all those who have read extensively concerning him, that he was a great man, a majestic figure, unquestionably the principal, the essential founder and champion of the American Republic. I wish to express my gratitude to a few persons and institutions that have recently given me special assistance. To Kathleen S. Alden, Madeline S. Thibault, the staffs of the public libraries of Clearwater, Florida, and Traverse City, Michigan, and of the National Archives, Emerson Ford of the Perkins Library of Duke University, Professor William Cooper of Louisiana State University, and above all, Professor William Abbott and his colleagues of the Papers of George Washington, who saved me from a number of errors. I wish also to acknowledge the unfailing helpfulness and kindness of the staff of the Louisiana State University Press. Chapter 1. The Young Virginian. At the end of his own time, and for generations thereafter, he was acclaimed at home and abroad as the founder of the American nation. He achieved sainthood in the minds of the Americans who came after him. There was a tendency to look upon him as an archangel who possessed the genius of Caesar, the vision of Moses, and the morals of Galahad. A change came. Later Americans gave more and more attention to their rights, less and less to the man who was the principal begetter of those rights. Scholars and teachers in America offered more and more praise to men of the era of the Revolution who talked and wrote in behalf of liberty, to those who labored at European capitals for independence, to those who remodeled American institutions. To Thomas Paine, Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, Alexander Hamilton, and James Madison. There was also in the 20th century a school of biographical debunkers who discovered that great men and women, American as well as European, were inconstant and incontinent, addicted to profanity and menaced by insanity. Among them were writers who sought to destroy the hallowed Washington, to reduce him to mortal or smaller proportions. They found sin in the saint. So doing, they tended to make the father of his country into an important scamp. It was often forgotten that the sword can be more potent than the pen, that the bayonet can speak more decisively than the tongue of the diplomat, that Washington was the one man essential to the triumph of the patriots in the War of Independence, to the creation of the American Union, and perhaps even to the success of the Democratic Revolution throughout the world. It is no secret that Washington was not born to the imperial purple, nor was he by birth a member of the first families of Virginia, the fabled Virginia aristocracy. He opened his eyes without fanfare of trumpets, with modest hereditary prestige, in a brick house near the junction of Pope's Creek with the Potomac River in Westmoreland County, Virginia, at 10 a.m. on February 11th, 1732, a day of the month that became February 22nd, when Britain and the British Empire afterward condescended to strike 11 days from their defective calendar to match it with that of the remainder of the Western world. He was later duly baptized in the Episcopal Church. He was not christened after King George III, who came into the world 6 years later. It has been urged that he was named after a George Eskridge, a benefactor of Washington's mother. It is not unlikely that the parents had King George II in mind. There was little reason at the time to believe that Washington...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.